Hey everybody, Chris Fafalius here. If you enjoy One Hit Thunder, which I'm assuming you do considering you're listening to it right now, I want to tell you about another great music podcast on the Evergreen Podcast Network. It's called Riffs on Riffs. On this season of Riffs on Riffs, hosts Toby Braswell and Joe Watson are breaking down one iconic pop song each week. Everything from Taylor Swift's Cruel Summer to Journey's Don't Stop Believin' to Naughty by Nature's OPP. Each week, they crack open the song, trace its history, decode those cryptic lyrics, and unearth the hidden gems in its musical DNA. Not only do they dive into the song's history, lyrics, and impact, they also go down some fun and oftentimes hilarious rabbit holes. So yeah, if you're a fan of One Hit Thunder, I think you'll also enjoy Riffs on Riffs. So go hit that subscribe button on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your pods.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, no, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. VGW Group. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply.
Patreon voted for us to dive into the group's swing out sister in their aptly named breakout hit, Breakout. Written by lead singer Corinne Drury while recovering from a fractured skull, the song emerged during a stressful period when the band was worried about being dropped from their label. Despite being prolific and never slowing down, they were never able to capture another hit on US radio. The band, known for their distinctive blend of jazz, pop, and sophisticated production, has maintained a loyal fan base and continues to release music that resonates deeply with listeners. Join us this week as we explore their career, from their early days to their continued evolution, and decide if Swing Out Sisters' catalog deserves way more of your attention.
One hit is all you need to make the money guaranteed, and you can live off royalties forever.
And it makes me wonder, is it just a wonder, or is it one hit thunder?
Matt, did you know this song before you knew we were going to do this episode?
So here's the weird thing. This is the thing that's going to blow your mind. I didn't know this song. But I had a different Swing Out Sister album growing up.
Wow. You had a whole album?
My mom had a whole album, and then when she didn't want it anymore, similar to my Sash Jordan album,
okay,
I got it. It was early in my music adventures. Now, I didn't listen to it a ton. It was Get in Touch with Yourself, their third album.
Third album, yeah.
Which I believe it was for the Am I the Same Girl cover on there. So like I've said in past episodes, my uncle was in a wedding band, and every once in a while they would want a song with a female vocalist, and my mom would be the female vocalist for when someone would request a song. And I guess someone's requested at the time that that song was on the radio for their wedding, either as the first dance or something else. So my mom bought the CD to learn the song, and then when she was done with it, she handed the CD to me.
Your mom got to play the role of Corinne Drury.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Pretty sweet. Well, for anyone who doesn't know, the actual biggest song, the one hit we're talking about today, is Breakout.
Yep.
I absolutely love this song.
It seems like a song you would love. When I was listening to it, you know how like you can listen to a song and say, oh, this is definitely something Matt Kelly likes? That's how I feel when I listen to Swing Out Sister. And I have to say, I like that third album a lot, the one that I said. So I was shocked I didn't actually know this one, which is obviously the song everyone knows by Swing Out Sister. They're fun. They're just a fun little two-piece.
Yeah. They were a three-piece back at the time of Breakout.
Yeah.
But now it is just Corinne Drury and Andy Connell. But yeah, this song, that chorus is so good. The don't stop to ask. Oh, it's so good. And Matt, you went out CD shopping
for a little while.
Boy, did I. That's what I do.
And boy, did I listen to a lot of Swing Out Sister while you were, while you were out. And I was working out while listening to it. And it really put me in the mind of being, if I didn't know they were from England, I would think that they were hip French, hip and French.
I could, yeah, they've got a real, like, if the Wes Anderson aesthetic was a band,
okay,
it would be Swing Out Sister.
It really makes me think of if I was going to Fashion Week in Paris and I was really taken in the sights of the city, their music would serve as a nice montage piece for it. And I really enjoyed everything I heard. And wow, am I impressed. Swing Out Sister, still together today. Prolific.
Never slowed down, honestly.
Never stopped. And why should they?
Why not? It's got to be, side note, it's got to be easier and more manageable to just keep cranking out records if you're just a two-piece.
Yeah, sure.
Less schedules you got to work around, less personalities you got to deal with. You just text your friend Andy and say, I got a song. And Andy says, I'll write some music. Let's do it.
Yeah. Pretty cool band. I watched some music videos, and she, but not so much anymore, but back then had the very boxy, angular, stylish haircut, which put me in the mind of something French, the bangs and the short hair. And she definitely had a look. And I was, and in the video for Breakout, they're playing with a lot of fabric and sewing machines and stuff, which makes sense because she was actually a fashion designer and a model.
Yep. Makes sense.
Yes, it does make sense. Their music puts me in that world. I mean,
they just lucked out because she also could sing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, there's plenty of worlds where they grab fashion models to be the vocalist of a band for whatever reason, and they can't. But she actually can. She can sing very well.
So Breakout went how high on the charts?
This thing peaked at six.
Six, okay.
Six on the Billboard charts, and give me, like, less than 2 seconds. And I can tell you even more about that. So it peaked at six on November 14th, 1987. And this was everything that was just out of its reach in the top five. Heaven is a Place on Earth.
Okay.
Belinda Carlisle. Number four, Little Lies by Fleetwood Mac.
Oh, that's a good one.
Number three, I've Had the Time of My Life by Bill Medley and Jennifer Warnes. Number two was Billy Idol's cover of Money Money.
Mm-hmm.
And number one, also a cover, Tiffany. I Think We're Alone Now.
Oh, okay. This is in the Tiffany era. All right. Tiffany was early, 87. Wow.
Yeah. Now, the whole, like, I mean, this song is, it's insane that I didn't know this song, right? Because it, not only did it peak at number six, which is pretty damn high, it was nominated for two Grammys. They were nominated for Best New Artist and Best Vocal Performance for the song Breakout.
Yeah, I remember seeing them nominated for Best New Artist. We've done somebody on the podcast before where we talked about that year.
Yeah, I'm going to look that up now because I didn't do that, and I feel like I need to know.
I need to know who they lost to.
Yeah, because we definitely covered this before. Mm-hmm. Like, there was definitely a world where Swing Out Sister Breakout was on the list of who was nominated when so-and-so won. I don't know why we talked about this. They lost to Jody Watley.
Okay.
And they were up against Breakfast Club, Terrence Trent
D'Arby,
and Cutting Crew.
Okay.
So really, I have to say, none of them were like, no one that was in the Best New Artist category that year are like prolific megastar level from that time point.
I would say that Swing Out Sister is probably the most prolific.
Probably the most prolific, but definitely not like a, like, they're not generating hits. You know what I mean? Like, it, none of them had like a mega career, especially, I mean, I guess that's constantly the case because the following year, Tracy Chapman got it. And as much as I love Tracy Chapman, she really only had Give Me One Reason and like Talking About a Revolution as the other kind of noteworthy songs in her career.
Yeah. It's interesting with Swing Out Sister that they were able to sustain their career through the 90s, through the 2000s. And a big part of that was their popularity in Japan.
Yeah.
They were big in Japan, and that's what kept them going. Some of these albums, that's where they sold, was Japan.
I mean, it is so interesting to me what bands and artists pop off in Japan versus which ones don't.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are like, there's like hair metal bands that are huge in Japan when they were like a one hit wonder in the States. There's like punk and ska bands that are like gods in Japan. And they're like, they're just a perfectly fine, like fondly remembered third wave ska band back in the States. Like it's kind of interesting what different genres that like, there's not just like a latch on, but like a long time loyalty
mm-hmm.
to that band. And Swing Out Sisters, one of those groups. It's not like, oh, they were big in the 80s in Japan. They were big for a couple years in Japan.
I think they still are. Their 2004 album was huge there. I was listening to the later albums, and I can kind of hear maybe why there's a sort of optimism to the music. There's a uplifting spirit, feel good nature of the music. It's real smooth. I don't know if it was attributed to them touring there a lot or, you know, just keeping up appearances there. They definitely have a stylish, cool aesthetic about them. But yeah, I don't know. They don't sing in Japanese or anything as far as anything I heard.
So what did you think about the album after this, though? So they do Breakout, which I think does feel of the time a little bit. And then they do Kaleidoscope World 2 years later, and they kind of abandon all of the contemporary style to do like a retro, almost easy listening music in the style of Burt Bacharach, and even got Burt Bacharach and songwriter Jimmy Webb to help like arrange some songs for him with like an orchestra and shit. It's one of the more insane like style shifts that I've heard in a while.
I don't know what songs are on what albums that I was listening to today, so I'm actually going to pull it up here.
You know, like, let's try, say, Forever Blue, maybe. That's one that Jimmy Webb helped write.
Wow.
Yeah.
This was their follow-up to Breakout.
Yeah. Like, I don't hate it, but it's so different.
That's interesting.
It almost feels like you're immediately like, okay, I get why they... I bet that alienated a lot of the people who liked Breakout.
Yeah, maybe. And they also had a member leave. That's when they became a two-piece in that album.
They lost their drummer.
He did write a few... He did get writing credit on a few of the songs on the album. That must have been written before he left, but they were been a two-piece ever since. And I've seen them... Dude, I watched them play from 1989, which would have been the year that Kaleidoscope World came out.
Yeah.
I watched a YouTube of them playing. It had something to do with Prince, okay? Prince put on this showcase or show or whatever and played Breakout and another song. And you know who the backing band was?
Who?
Level 42.
Oh, hell yeah, man. Level 42 keeps sneaking up in unexpected ways on our show.
And it makes sense that Level 42 and Swing Out Sister would play together. I got to see that sick-ass bass.
Hey, one-hit thunders. Thunderheads. Thunder buns. All right, I'll just go with one-hit thunder listeners. This is Krista Makes, guitarist and vocalist for Less Than Jake, and host of Krista Makes a Podcast. A songwriting podcast where every week I'm joined by an amazing guest to break down the writing, recording, and release of one iconic song that they have written. In our giant evergreen back catalog of episodes, we've had rock legends such as Dee Snider and Huey Lewis, punk rock favorites such as Mark Hoppus, Fat Mike, and Brett Gurewitz, up-and-coming artists of today such as Liz Stokes of The Beths and Genesis Owusu, and even some of the artists that have been featured on One Hit Thunder. The show is even produced by One Hit Thunder host Chris Fafalius. What more could you possibly ask for? Krista Makes a Podcast is available for free on all the places you listen to podcasts, and new episodes come out every Monday. I guarantee you'll like it, or we'll give you your money back.
So let me ask you a question, Chris. Did you read anything about the song Breakout?
No, I don't know much about the song itself.
All right, so the lead singer, Corinne.
Corinne, yeah.
Corinne. Wrote the song while she was recovering from a fractured skull from an equestrian accident.
Whoa.
So she was riding a horse and fucked up her skull. And it was one of the two songs for a two-song deal that they had with Mercury Records. The first song that they released failed to chart. And Mercury said that the band had to have a second demo in by the next Monday morning or risk being dropped, which made them write and compose the song under a lot of stress. Hmm. So the song was kind of quickly thrown together. And then it obviously was exactly what Mercury Records was hoping for and jumped to, like I said, number six on the charts. This influenced the lyrics. This influenced the lyrics as well as her desire to quit her day job as a fashion designer to become a singer. There was a little bit of controversy around the bass line, claiming that the band had taken it from an unpublished record track. But the band said that it was inspired by the 1986 FIFA World Cup TV theme song in Brazil.
What? That's strange. Well, it's funny how much I love this song and never paid attention to the lyrics whatsoever. Yeah. When explanations make no sense, when every answer's wrong, you're fighting with lost confidence, all expectations gone. The time has come to make or break. Move on, don't hesitate, break out.
Yeah. That sounds like some lyrics about wanting to do what you want to do.
Yeah. I like it. Don't stop to ask. And now you found a way. Now you found a break to make it last. If you got to find a way, say what you want to say, break out. Man, that's nice.
Yeah. She wrote some good lyrics for this one.
Did she write the lyrics?
Yeah.
We're assuming she wrote the lyrics.
Well, it said she wrote the lyrics while recovering from a fractured skull.
Okay. Nice. Man, a fractured skull.
That's fucked, man.
That's rough.
I have lived a fairly blessed life of mostly living injury-free.
Mm-hmm.
Strongly just comes from not really leaving my house too much and drinking lots of milk. So these bones are real fucking strong. I can't imagine, like, there are so many people that have, like, fractured skull, like broken parts of their skull. My girlfriend, literally, if you feel the side of her head, you can feel where the crack was in her skull from when she fell down a flight of stairs.
Oh.
And I'm just like, that would scare the shit out of me.
Like, oh, my God. I don't even want to think about fracturing my skull.
Yeah, no, let's not. I mean, we can change the subject. Yeah. I'm just saying that's crazy. While we're still on that topic for a split second, imagine like if you did that, and then as you're recovering from it, you also have to write a hit song in over the weekend.
Do you think Breakout was from breaking her skull and the brains coming out?
You know what? That's going to be my headcanon. That's what that song's about.
Definitely. That's what this song's about. Pretty cool band. You know, it's funny. I was listening to, you know how they put together like the CDs. I'm going to, they're like these.
Oh boy, do I know CDs.
Yeah, you do know CDs. But the 20th Century Masters like that. I'm showing Matt the cover. These type of things that are basically, greatest hits albums. And they all have this uniform way that they put the name of the title
on
the
top. It's like White Grazing Golds, basically.
Yeah. But the second song, this song called Surrender, I always talk about this, but the musically, it kind of reminded me of Sonic the Hedgehog. Once it kicks in.
Oh, yeah.
Can't you see Sonic the Hedgehog level set to this?
Yeah, he's walking real slow, but he's starting to speed up to do his little ball roll to get a bunch of rings.
This is so Sonic.
It was their follow-up single to Breakout.
Yeah.
It actually hit number 7 on the UK charts in January of 87. So well before the song was blowing up in the States, that was already blowing up on the UK. Then they also had the singles Twilight World and Fooled by a Smile on the UK success side of things. Mm-hmm. It actually was the number one album in the UK when it came out.
Wow.
It's Better to Travel. So they were a big deal, at least in the UK. I don't know if they were like massive beyond that first album in the UK, but definitely they are one of those groups that if you're not in the States listening to our podcast, you're like, swing out, sister, are we? Say they're a one-hit wonder, ain't it?
I love that in 94, I watched the music video for it. They did a cover of the Delphonics' La La Means I Love You.
Oh.
La 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 means I love you.
Love that.
Michael or Jackson 5 also did that song. But I thought that was a pretty interesting. They have a lot of influences. I don't know, like, exactly what kind of music they are outside of just
well, because soul, they jumped around
soul kind of too.
Like we said, they did their second album was easy listening. When they got to the third album, the Get In Touch With Yourself, it was like a dancier album. It almost felt like it was pulling from like all types of stuff. So it says here that the tracks on that album drew influence from both 60s and 70s jazz as well as pop, soul, and funk music.
Yeah. And then you get to like their later 90s music that I listened to, like that Shapes and Patterns album.
Yeah.
And they have like orchestral arrangements them.
So that's the interesting thing. It was saying that when they made their album The Living Return in 94, which has that La 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 I Love You, that like from the throughout the rest of their career, they always remained a two-piece band, but like they needed usually up to 10 people to replicate their sound live.
Right. I like that.
They're still, I mean, their most recent album came out in 2017. Like, they just have not slowed down. They keep doing their thing. And thankfully, I think we both kind of dig what their thing is, even if their thing is all types of different music. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like this is the opposite of what we were complaining about with Jimmy's Chicken Shack, right? Like, with Jimmy's Chicken Shack, we were talking about how, like, they jumped around in genres and it felt like there was no consistency or through line. Mm-hmm. But somehow, like, Swing Out Sister, no matter whether they're doing something jazzy or something funky or something poppy, it never doesn't feel like it's from the same band.
It never doesn't feel like I'm about to walk out on the runway and have my photo taken during Fashion Week in Paris.
Exactly. That's exactly the mood that they're going for, and it's the mood that they're hitting out of the park.
We assume they're going for.
No, I think we know.
Mm-hmm.
That was what they were aiming for. They wanted Fashion Week in Paris mood.
Was
their specific angle.
I could definitely see that. And then, like you said, their most recent album from 2017, Almost Persuaded. They actually did that on Pledge Music. Now, is Pledge Music that shady site?
That's
where
the shady site you were talking about on a previous episode.
Yeah. But I guess their album came out, so at least they didn't get screwed over in the end. And pretty cool that they're still at it. I think I'm a fan, and I think I want to listen to them more because I've always liked Breakout. I just never dug deeper.
Yeah.
I'm glad we do a podcast that makes me dig deeper on music that I would like. I'm a pop head. I just fall in love with stuff like this.
Yeah, maybe after listening to this episode, we can break out a couple Swing Out Sister CDs and hang out.
Do you want to do that now? Does that mean this is Thunder?
I think this is Thunder. I don't think we have to put it to a vote. I think it's you know, la-di-da-di-da, Swing Out Sister, it's coming in the mail.
I love a good success story after a cracked skull.
Yeah. It's my favorite type of success story. Mm-hmm. Is a post-cracked skull success story.
Just another cracked skull success story.
Stop running around, because no one here is proud. Once lady like Miss Katie White finds herself upside down.
This has been One Hit Thunder. One Hit Thunder is hosted by Chris Ophaios of the band Punchline and produced by Matt Kelly of Geekscape.net. Underneath me, you're hearing 21 Forever off the Punchline album Delightfully Pleased. Visit punchlinemusic.com for any upcoming news on the band. Our podcast is on Patreon now. Find us at patreon.com/OHTpodcast for early access to episodes, bonus episodes, and a chance to vote on future songs for us to cover. Be sure to rate, review, and subscribe to us on your favorite podcasting app. And tune in next week for more One Hit Thunder.
to the Geekscape Network.
Hey there, I am Johnny Christ from Avenged Sevenfold, and I've got a podcast called Drinks with Johnny you're going to want to check out. I sit down with a bunch of different people from all different walks of life, from professional wrestlers to actors, comedians, fighters, musicians, everything in between. I'm just looking to make some friends and have a good time doing it. So if that sounds like something you're into, go check out Drinks with Johnny, streaming everywhere now.
Welcome to us talking about our podcast for a minute.
What's the name of that podcast?
That's Axe to Grind. And right now you're going to be getting a little taste of it, right down to the shaky microphone and all.
And my name's Bob.
And my name's Patrick. And usually we're joined by Tom.
Tom's the best. Tom has a real grown-up job that requires him to be at work. But we talk about decidedly not so grown-up things like
hardcore music and things that people that like hardcore music tend to like.
So that could be the latest shows, revisiting classic material, talking about the new classics, all the little dorm room nonsense that you imagine from a niche music podcast that you either love, want to love, or hate.
Yeah, imagine all the emotions that you have towards a genre that has impacted your life, and then condense them down to an hour to 2 hours a week.
So triangulate your speakers, think about jumping off the bed, singing along, dancing like an idiot, and listen to Axe to Grind podcast.